Welcome to St. Mark's United Church on January 23rd, 2022. Thank you for joining us for worship. It is with grateful hearts that we acknowledge that God is with us everywhere. So no matter where we are, let us join our hearts and minds for worship this day.
Thank you.
Welcome to this place and space, where the good news is shared, where the good news is witnessed, where the good news is enacted. Welcome as we come to worship the God of good news. Amen. Patient God, we've been coming to church for years, some of us for more years than others, and we keep hearing these two words over and over again. Good news. Good news. Sometimes it seems like good news is in short supply. Supply shortages, job loss, energy costs, flooding in one place, droughts in another, forest fires and rising sea levels, pandemic, and on it goes. It can drown out the good news. So help us today to listen again to Jesus and catch some of the excitement, the exhilaration of listening to world-changing news, spoken, not in a room far away, not in a TV studio under the lights, but right here in our own worship time, as Jesus did in his home synagogue. Amen.
Luke chapter 4, verses 14 to 21. Jesus in the synagogue at Nazareth. Then Jesus returned to Galilee, full of the Holy Spirit's power. Soon he became well known throughout all the region for his sermons in the synagogues. Everyone praised him. When he came to the village of Nazareth, his boyhood home, he went, as usual, to the synagogue on Saturday and stood up to read the scriptures. The book of Isaiah, the prophet, was handed to him, and he opened it to the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has appointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted and to announce that captives will be released and the blind will see and the downtrodden will be freed from their oppressors, and that God is ready to give blessings to all who come to him." He closed the book, handed it back to the attendant, sat down, and while everyone in the synagogue gazed at him intently, he said, "These scriptures came true today."
Thank you.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable unto you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. In 1982, a movie version of the musical Annie was released. I lived very close to the Center Mall, and there was a cinema there. And I can remember several hot afternoons walking over to the cinema to see the movie Annie. It was one of my favorites. I love musicals, and the songs from that movie in particular have rolled around in my head for a very long time. One song, though, the song that Annie sung when she was feeling lonely as an orphan, when she was feeling unwanted, used and abused by those who were meant to care for her. She put all her hopes into tomorrow. She dreamt that things would be better tomorrow, that the future would be better than today.
The song I used to sing in the orphanage when I'd get sad, it always cheered me up.
Eleanor!
Just thinking about tomorrow clears away the cobwebs and the sorrow till there's none. When I'm stuck with a day that's gray and lonely, I just stick out my chin and grin and say, oh, the sun'll come out tomorrow, so you gotta hang on till tomorrow. Come what may, tomorrow, tomorrow, I love ya, tomorrow, you're only a day away.
I think most of us can relate to this song. Times in our lives and situations that seem bleak. I would say all of us during this time of COVID have felt that tomorrow might be better than today. We've dreamt of times when we no longer need to wear masks, when we no longer need to attend church virtually, when we can gather with our families and have fun and feast together. We often envision that tomorrow things will be brighter and happier. In today's reading, we hear about a Jewish congregation very much experiencing a moment in their lives as a community where they were hoping that things would get better in the future. Their present situation was miserable. They were oppressed by the Roman government. They were poor. Laws were unjust, taxes were excessive. They longed for that brighter tomorrow. For Annie, the solution she imagined was that she would one day have parents who would come and care for her and take her away from the horrible situation that she lived in. For the Jewish community, the solution that they had prayed and waited for was the arrival of a Messiah, God's chosen one, who would free them and make their nation powerful and respected by their enemies. In hopes of the Messiah's arrival, they not only prayed, but they gathered each week to worship God, sing praises, listen to the words of Torah, their scripture, and they tried to make sense of everything the Torah had to tell them. They worshiped on the Sabbath as a way of keeping hope for a future when the Messiah would arrive. Gathering in the synagogue was important, but on this Sabbath morning, the gathering was full of expectation, not for the anticipated Messiah, but because their hometown boy Jesus had been causing a frenzy with his preaching in neighboring communities. They wanted to hear him for themselves. And word about town was that he'd come home and would be in the synagogue that day. Jesus did not disappoint them. After the recitations from Deuteronomy and Numbers, after the prayers, Jesus volunteered to read the Torah. It was a tradition that any Jewish male could volunteer to read the Torah or preach, so nothing was unusual about Jesus taking part in the service. He was handed the scroll from Isaiah, and he opened it and read, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." At this point in the telling of the story, it would seem that something strange had happened, for no one present spoke. All sat in silence, staring at Jesus. Had Jesus read a scripture that wasn't planned for? Or had he read the right one? Had people clicked on to what it meant? We will never know, but when Jesus sat down in the usual position to preach from, all he said was, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." In that moment, Jesus claimed his identity as the Messiah and stated his mission. In Luke, everything Jesus says or does from that moment on can be held up against this reading from Isaiah and found to be true to Jesus' mission. The silence in the room spoke volumes. There were shock and surprise. How had they missed who Jesus was as he was growing up? To cut the community some slack, the reality was that Jesus was not the same. He had experienced several events since he left home, which helped him come to this point in his life. He had been baptized and the Holy Spirit filled him. He was named and claimed by God. He went into the desert and was tempted to use his power to control others. He had been tempted to get whatever he wanted, and the Holy Spirit guided him safely through all those temptations. He began preaching and telling folks about the kingdom of God and how different it is from the earthly kingdoms that they all knew, and the Holy Spirit empowered him to do this work. So when Jesus comes back to his hometown to claim his name, his mission, the Holy Spirit is still upon him. The Jesus that had come home was full of the Holy Spirit, and with and through the Spirit, he had the strength, the courage, and the faith that would allow him to be successful in his ministry. The same Spirit was gifted to Jesus' followers, his disciples, the early church, and yes, even us. Early on in Christian history, the Holy Spirit was all Jesus' followers had. They had no buildings, money, or believers that they relied on. They relied instead on Jesus and the Holy Spirit to help them on the way. They could feel the Holy Spirit and recognize its presence with them as they successfully followed in Jesus' footsteps and made a difference in the lives of the poor, the oppressed, the blind, and the imprisoned. As followers of Jesus today, it has become harder to define success. Our buildings, staff, the number of people sitting in pews, community and committee activities define us and demonstrate our success to ourselves and others. But can we still feel the Holy Spirit? Are we really successful in the ministry Jesus has handed over to us? The ministry of care and compassion to the poor, the oppressed, and the blind. Do our structures physically and relationally bring about the jubilee or new beginnings for all? Do we feel the Holy Spirit's strength as we plan our budget and seek to further Jesus' mission? Can we say we feel the Holy Spirit's guidance as we open our doors and hearts to those who are different than us? Can we say we have been illuminated by the Spirit as we help each other and the stranger see that we are all loved by God? Have we allowed the Holy Spirit to be part of what we do? Or are we afraid to trust the Spirit and therefore limit our ministry because of the expectations of others and what society says is successful? If we are to be successful and to do our part in Jesus' mission, we must make room for the Spirit and trust in its leading. Jesus could not begin or continue his ministry without the Spirit, nor can we. And the same Spirit that worked in and with Jesus is the Spirit that works in and through us. Jesus could wait no longer to set his ministry into motion. There was never going to be a perfect time, the perfect place, enough money, or enough followers, so he decided to act, trusting in the Spirit. Some might say that the church must act now as well. For just like Jesus, there will never be a perfect time or place, enough money or volunteers. But the Spirit is with us, and the time is now. May the ministry we take up in the name of Jesus to bring good news to the poor, release the captives, bring sight to the blind and freedom to the oppressed, be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit, and may we all do our part to bring God's kingdom closer to a reality in this time and place. Amen. Jesus picked up the scroll at Sabbath day and read these words: "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, and to the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." This turned out to be Jesus' mission, and as Jesus' followers, it is our mission too. The offerings that you make to the church allow the ministry and mission of Jesus to continue in our time and place. Your gifts can be mailed to the church office, e-transferred through the church office email, or dropped off in the door. Let us take this time now to bless the gifts of time, talent, and money that have been shared with St. Mark's. Thank you. news, giver of gifts. In you there is freedom, with you there is hope. Transformer of lives, we bring our gifts to you, an offering from our lives and of our lives, that they and we may be used to continue to proclaim your favor, and that the eyes of all will be drawn to you. Amen. Kingdom, O God, is of justice and joy, where all may flourish and grow into their full potential. Your kingdom, O God, is of abundance and peace, where all may prosper and live without fear and shame. Your kingdom, O God, is of restoration and relationship, where all belong and everyone is welcome. We pray for all held captive by poverty and want, by the burden of debt, by the fear of failure, by illness of body, mind, or spirit, by prison doors. We pray for all who are oppressed by totalitarian regimes, by corrupt governments, by systemic bullying in workplaces, homes, or schools. We pray for all yearning for your good news of liberation, of restoration, of connection and community. As your people, help us to work for the coming of your kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven, bringing light, bringing hope, bringing love wherever we are in our small corner of your world. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. The Spirit of the Lord rest upon us all. May we go inspired by Jesus. May we serve the kingdom wherever we see need, and do it all in the name of God and for the sake of the gospel. Amen.